Welcome to our sessions. I decided to put some R videos here to help you working with R. I noticed that some of you have some difficulties when you go back home and want to work on R, and that's quite natural. Whenever you deal with any software, you have to follow these steps very carefully, and after that, if you just miss one step, you cannot run the codes the way that they need to be. So I decided to design these tutorials here, and I start from the beginning. So for those of you who want to have a review of the things that have been covered in the class, that might be a very good idea to start looking over what is covering now. So let's get started and see what we have. So one of the things I want to emphasize here is that R is not a very low-level programming language, although you can do almost everything with it. What I need from you in this course is not low-level, so you need to use just high-level functions and just know how to deal with those functions. So the first couple of sessions would be on a couple of things that are necessary to understand the whole thing here. But after that, I'm just going to show you how to use the functions. And that is the one that you need for your projects and your homework. So let's get started with the easiest concepts here. The first thing I want to teach you is how to get a working directory from your R. See where R is looking after for data now. The simple command for that is get WD. That's get working directory. So if you run that, oh, by the way, whenever you want to run anything on R, you should just go, just take that command and press command and enter. So here, for instance, it shows that my working directory now is user Hamed data mining course at the bottom of the screen. Let's say you want to change that working directory. How can you do that? The easy way to do that is to go on this window. And here you can see three dots here, right? So if you want to change the working directory to some other place, you just need to click on these three dots, then go and pick the directory you want. So let's say I saved everything that we have here in a folder called data mining course. So I just want to fix it to here, so I just press open. If you want to if you want to save it as the working directory, just click on more. And when you click on it, just set it as the working directory. Okay? So that's how you set the working directory. That means anytime you need to load any data from it, that's the place you should look after. So that's how you set your working directory. Now let's go and introduce vectors and scalars and see how you can work with those. So the first thing I want to mention is, if you want to write some comments for yourself, and you want to let R know that they're not affecting anything, just use this hashtag or number sign and just write whatever you want. So I said that this is how you need to write your comments. I think it has just one. Okay, comments. Okay, perfect. So that's how you write the comments. So the first thing I want to cover is how to define vectors and matrices. Okay. The easy way to define vectors is just write a simple case that is starting with C. So if you want to have a vector of size 3, that means it had 3 elements in it. You just write x is equal to c and those 3 elements. So here in our course, we have c of, I think we had c of 275. I just want to be very very much consistent with the notes you have. So x, c of 275 has 3 elements. So if you just write x now, it gives you 275. Let's say you want to introduce another vector, and you just want to give it some order. Let's say you want to have a size of 3 vector, starts from 4 and goes five by five. The way you do it is just using sequence. So anything you write inside it will give you the commands you want. And one thing to note is that if you're not familiar with the command here, you just want to use it, just use question mark before that function. It gives you everything that you need. For instance, if you're not sure what this function sequence doing, just write question mark sequence. It gives you everything that you want. For instance, here it says, okay, from some place to another place by some increments. So that's the only thing we know. So okay, so we just do and replicate what is written there. It's okay, it should have from and to and by. So let's do that. So we start from 4 we go up to a value, let's say 10, and we just increase it by 1. So let's see how it does it. So y in this case would be anything from 5 to 10, because that's how it's defined. Another way to define a SQL is to use some other components with it. For example, you can say, okay, from four, generate a vector of length 3, and just add the elements by 5. That means start from four, generate a vector that only has a size 3, that has 3 elements, but each element is 5 units more than the previous one. So we have 4, 9, and 12. So let's see what it does. So let me run it. So y in this case would be 4, 9, and 14. 9 is 5 units more than 4, and 14 is 5 units more than 9. Okay? So if you want to add two vectors, it's very easy. It's just like x plus y. And x plus y, here you see the outcome. X plus y is 6, 16, and 19. Why? Because x was 2, 7, 5. Y is 4, 9, 14. The summation would be the element summation. So there would be 6, 16, and 19. That's how you do it. The next thing I want to share is how you divide two vectors, how you multiply. It's easy, it's just like any other programming language. So if you want to divide two outcomes, just divide it this way. So that would be the element division. So here it would be 2 divided by 4, which is 0.5, 7 divided by 16, which is 0.77, and so on and so forth. And that's the same thing for multiplication and power. So if you want to have an element to element power, that would be a very large number. I'm not sure if R can handle it. Yes, it did. It does it element by element. For instance, 2 to the power of 4 is 16, 7 to the power of 9 is that large number, and 5 to the power of 14 is that very large number. So we're done with the vectors. Sometimes you want to manipulate things. If you want to manipulate things and have access to certain numbers here, then you have to use this format. So for instance, I want to have access to the second element of this vector, which is vector x, which is 7. I want to have access to that. You just put it in. You just use this format. If you want to have access to more of the elements, let's say I want to have access to element 2 to 3 of this x would be 7 and 5. You just use 2, 2, 3. That's how you do it. So that gives you 7 and 5. That's very easy to work with. One of the things that is very easy to work with is when you want to drop something from a vector or a data set. The way you can drop it is perhaps the most efficient one. Let's say you want to just drop the second element of x. Again, I use the same format we had, but instead of 2, I just write minus 2. That means just drop 2 from this element. So x will become 2 and 5 now. So the elements that are left will be 2 and 5. Let's say you want to drop more than 2 elements from here. You can do that easily too. You just say x, drop the first 2 elements. Here, remember when you wanted to ask it to give you more than one variable, you have a vector, you should put it in C, and that's exactly how you do it here. So x minus C of 1 to 2 drops anything that is x. So what is left is just 5, because 1 to 2 was 2 and 7, as you can see here. So the only thing that is left is 5. The next thing is how you define matrices. We are not going to use matrices directly in the course, but our data sets, if you think about it, are just matrices. So let's see how we deal with matrices. The way to deal with matrices, again, defining a vector and just put it in the matrix. So the way you introduce matrix is using matrix. That's how you introduce matrix. And one thing you put there is, so let's say I want to build a matrix from 1 to 12, and that will be a 3x4 matrix. So in the beginning, I just say, okay, that is from 1 to 12. My number of rows is 3, and number of columns is 4. So that way, I created a Z matrix that has 3 rows and 4 columns, and the elements of that is from 1 to 12. So if I just recall Z, the outcome would be 1 to 12 in a 1x4 matrix. So one thing that is sometimes being asked is, that, okay, how can I have access to some elements of this matrix? Let's say you want to have access to 5, which is the second row and second column of this this matrix. So that's very easy. Just like vectors, you just write the address of where you're looking after here. But here, your address is 2 elements, row and column. So if you run it, it just gives you the element you're looking after. Sometimes you want to just drop or keep some of the elements here. Again, you do the same thing. You just drop it the same way you used to drop it. Let's say I'm interested to drop the very first element of the matrix. That's how I, the very first row of the matrix. I say, okay, I'm interested in Z minus 1. That means from my first rows, I don't need anything, and comma, nothing. That means from the second row, I need everything. So if you run it, that element drops everything that is in the first row, and keeps everything else. Remember this, it's vital to keep this comma here. Or let's say you're interested to just drop the second column from this matrix. That's also very easy. You don't need to mess with anything in rows. That's why I just put comma here. That means nothing has happened to the rows. And for columns, I just want to drop the second column. That's also relatively easy. As you can see, this was our original Z. This is where we just drop the second column. And you can play with that more. Let's say you want to drop the second column up to the third column, then you have to put it to the inside a vector. So if you run it, it just drops the second and third column of the matrix. So you can play with that. That was something you will use, or you have already used for homework number 1. One of the very cool things about matrices is that you can get the dimension of them very easily. So you just put dim, D-I-M gives the dimension of the matrix. Remember, your data sets are usually in the form of matrix. If they're not, the data frame is usually matrix. So if you want to get the dimensions of it, you just use dim of Z. It gives you 3m4, that means it had 3 rows and 4 columns. Another command that you can use is length. The length gives you the whole size of the matrix. They said the length is 12. That's 3 times 4, so it gives you the total number of